two scripture lessons from the Matthew 5 and 6, the Sermon on the Mount. Jesus speaking, "You are the light of the world. A city set on a hill cannot be hid. Nor do people light a lamp and put it under a bushel, but on a stand, and it gives light to all in the home. Let your light so shine before all people that they may see your good works and give glory to your Father who is in heaven." And now from the sixth chapter, starting with verse 1, "Beware of practicing your piety before other people in order to be seen by them, for then you will have no reward from your Father who is in heaven. Thus, when you give alms, sound a trumpet before you, as the hypocrites do in the synagogue and in the streets, and they may be praised by others. Truly, I say to you, they have received their reward. But when you give alms, do not let your left hand know what your right hand is doing, so that your alms may be given in secret, and your Father who sees in secret will reward you. And when you pray, you must not be like the hypocrites, for they love to stand and pray in the synagogues and in the streets, that they may be seen by others. Truly, I say to you, they have received their reward. But when you pray, go into your room and shut the door and pray to your Father who is in secret, and your Father who sees in secret will reward you." Friends, this is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Amen. This is a different kind of Ash Wednesday, isn't it? I mean, for one, here I am sitting in my living room talking to you who are several miles away. You can nod off during this service and the preacher won't even know. But it's also an odd kind of evening because we don't meet very often in the evening for worship. Monday, Thursday, Christmas Eve. But those are other kinds of services that mark other kinds of occasions. This is a reminder on Ash Wednesday that we are dust, and to dust we shall return. It's one of the days when we mark life's journey. Like our life, we are marking where we are and what we might or might not do in these next 40 days or so. On this Ash Wednesday, I took our attention to Jesus' Sermon on the Mount, where, according to Matthew, he reminded his followers of his credo, the purpose, a statement of all the good things that he could and should stand for. In these darker days of Lent, when the sun is struggling to cast some warmth upon this cold earth, I remind you on this day that Jesus said, "You are the light of the world. Let your light so shine before others that they may know your good works and give glory to your Father who is in heaven." You are the light of the world. Now, that's a rather strange statement for Jesus to make to us. For after all, doesn't the Bible tell us that Jesus was the light of the world? Several times Jesus said, "Follow Jesus into the light." The Bible says that. John said, "Jesus is the light of the world. Go follow after him. You, my followers, you within the sound of my voice," Jesus is saying, "you are the light of the world." And then he goes on to say that we have to do something about that light. "Let your light so shine before others that they may see your good works and give glory to your Father who is in heaven." Wow. Now, have you ever known anyone who has done that? Let their light shine before others? Were they Presbyterians? Now, you know Presbyterians don't like a whole lot of fanfare, do we? We like to keep things quiet when we allow our light to shine. But think back with me about those occasions when you perhaps allowed your light to shine. Maybe you were one of the ones who went down to Texas and crossed the border into Mexico years ago as part of the Presbytery's mission project to build homes for people who didn't have a place to live. That was letting your light shine. Or maybe last summer you encouraged someone to go on a mission project somewhere here within the bounds of Georgia. Or maybe last week you helped someone who was in need. You reached in your pocket and you pulled out some folding money and said, go buy whatever it is you need. Or maybe you brought a can of food to church to give to someone else. Lots of ways that we allow our light to shine in big and small ways. All because Jesus had a vision for us. Let your light shine before others that they may see your good works and give glory to your Father who is in heaven. Now remember, it says you are the light of the world, not the light of the church, not the light of committee work or the light off in the corner somewhere. You are the light of the world. Back in Isaiah 42, the prophet said to Israel, God wants you to be a light to the nations of the world. The idea will be so that those nations will come to Jerusalem and see the light of God. And Jesus is bringing, I believe, that same metaphor here for us in this Sermon on the Mount. Now, turn the page with me for a moment. Some people are scared by big cities. They can't understand why people live in them. At night, especially, they seem so big and dark and shadowy. Figures always lurking in the background. Not much light there. I remember one night when I was dropping 20 youngsters and a handful of adult chaperones off in the middle of the inner city. That was years ago now, but the memory is still fresh. We'd been on a weekend retreat. It was an interracial retreat. Teenagers from an almost all-white suburban church, along with teenagers from an inner city church, Black youngsters, adult chaperones both. And we were coming back on a Sunday night, and the bus, and I happened to be the bus driver in this event, so one of those school buses they allowed us to rent back in those days, broke down on the highway. And it took us hours to get that bus fixed and on the way again. And it was past midnight when I arrived at the destination for those Black teenagers and their adult chaperones in the middle of an intercity neighborhood. I knew once they got off the bus, I would be alone on that bus and I would have to turn the corner and go back down a very dark and risky street, I thought, one I was not familiar with at all, to get back on the main road. But then one of the lads who was getting off the bus said, "Let me help you, Reverend. I'll stay on the bus and I'll guide you down that lonely, dark street because it's not a risky street for me. It's home to me. I'll be your light in the dark," he said. So what darkness are you going through just now? Do you need someone to stop and say to you, "Don't worry, I'll be your guide down this dark street"? You are the light of the world, remember? Now, Matthew 6 is the opposite of Matthew 5. It says, when you do something for someone else, don't make a big show of it. When you give to the poor, don't let your right hand know what your left hand is doing. So which is it, Lord? Am I to be the light shining in the darkness before others, or am I to not allow one hand to know what the other hand is doing. Jesus' words have both the light of the world and don't let others know in the same sermon, just a couple of paragraphs apart. Jesus went off by himself on many occasions and prayed for other people and didn't always tell them what he was doing. And he also healed in public as a sign of the coming kingdom of God. I think he's telling us to do both. The Bible says you are the light of the world. A city set upon a hill cannot be hid. Neither do people light a candle and put it under a bushel, but on a stand. And it gives light to the whole house. Let your light so shine before others that they may see your good works and give glory to your heavenly parents. So friends, pick your journey this Lent. Decide how exactly you want to spend these 40 days. And then go out and do something where you are true to yourself and to the Lord that you worship and who calls you to serve him. Amen. Now, one of the things you might expect on Ash Wednesday is the imposing of ashes. That's not possible tonight. But we can hear a little bit of the liturgy about that bring more in focus for us about our mortality as we head down these 40 days of Lent. So pray with me. Almighty God, you have created us out of the dust of the earth. Teach us again that only by your gracious gift are we given everlasting life through Jesus Christ, our Savior. I invite you, therefore, in the name of Christ, to observe a holy Lent by self-examination and penitence, by prayer and fasting, by works of love, and by reading and meditating on the Word of God. O Lord, we ask this through Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. We're now going to transition from thinking about the ashes to into our service of communion, a service where we are reminded whose we are and who calls us each and every time we gather around the table, whether it be the table in the sanctuary of a holy place or whether it be the holy place of our homes, where we gather in another kind of circle of love. Jesus reminds us that people will come to this love feast of God from the east and the west, from the north and from the south, and gather around table, where they will remember the words of our Jesus Christ, who on the night in which he was betrayed, took a common loaf of bread, and after he gave thanks and blessed it, he broke it and said, "This is my body broken for you. Take, eat in remembrance of me." And after the meal, he also took a common cup and said, "This cup is the new covenant made in my blood. Drink this in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, do remember the Lord's death until he comes again." And so now I'm ministering in his name, take these elements and set them aside from their common to this most holy occasion. Also the elements you hold, I set them aside from this holy for this holy occasion. And ask now that you take the bread item that you have placed is the item that you will use for the body of Christ, and take, eat all of it. And whatever item you have for your cup, the liquid in your cup, I ask that you take this as a reminder that this is the blood of Christ poured out for the many for the forgiveness of sins. Drink ye all of it. Let us pray. God of love, as in Jesus Christ you gave yourself to us, so may we give ourselves to you, living according to your holy will. Keep our feet firmly in the way where Christ leads us. Make our mouths speak the truth that Christ teaches us. Fill us with the life that is Christ within us. We thank you for this sacrament, O Lord. We thank you for this time of remembrance and remembering the image of Christ as we partake of this sacrament. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever and ever. Amen. The words of assurance. That God not only hears our prayers, but God forgives us for our transgressions. Jesus said, God sent me into the world so that through me, people could see the love of God and know that they were forgiven for their transgressions. Jesus came into the world not to judge the world or condemn the world, but that we peoples of the world might be saved, and that a loving God awaits us. Amen. And so now may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace, both now and forevermore. Amen. Let the people say, amen.
Amen.
All right. This concludes our service.
Thank you, Glenn. Thank you for leading us in this. Very much appreciate it. And may all of you have a blessed and restful night tonight, and thank you for joining us.
Yes, thank you all for joining us.
Right.
Good night.
Good night, everyone.